ông quỳ chỗ. Ông chúng mình đã báo cáo phần to cái tâm nạc ca này thì tâm nạc ca thì to thế này bắt đầu bị cái chuyện từ dạ mình bị cái đấy lúc ở nguồn chí nó mới miền ốc ca phần to ca tăng xâm lúc đến đâu thì buồn lại chìm đến
Thank you,
Mr. President.
Good afternoon, Your Honours. Mr. Hinton, before the break in the morning, I have tried to see if I could establish with you that as of at least 17 April 1975, Vietnam was rightfully considered by CPK or by Democratic Kampuchea, but also by countries like China, the US, and Indonesia, as a very clear and at that time present danger to Cambodia's sovereignty, national
security, and that
when DK or the CPK were speaking about UN's policy, that they were not in fact, to use your terms, dehumanizing people, but that they were clearly speaking about Vietnam's policy and Vietnam's threat.
And
subsequently, that those who were suspected of collaborating with Vietnam,
understandably
and possibly rightfully regarded as potential traitors. And as a matter of fact, just to remind you, the trial chamber itself
ចាត់លោកសាស្ត្រាចារ្យហើយនៅក្នុងសំណាក់ការដូចក៏បានបញ្ជាក់ដែរយើងក៏រំលឹកដែរពាក់ព័ន្ធទៅនឹងសង្គ្រាមរវាងកម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យនិងប្រទេសវៀតណាមថាវាជាចំណុចមួយដែលយើងត្រូវពិភាក្សាហើយអ្វីដែលខ្ញុំចង់កត់សម្គាល់នោះគឺពាក់ព័ន្ធទៅនឹងការបង្កើត
Talking about one in every 30
8 8 6 2 5 6 6 5 0 0 0 6 4 5 9 9
601 in French
0005 24076 and 77 happy 76 76 77 now this document says
the following and I will read it during just the nearly 10 months began to overtly commit aggression against our Kampuchea.
On the other hand, the Yun are aggressors who caused the war in Kampuchea and the Southeast Asia region.
And then it says,
Would you like to say something?
Thank you, Your Honor. Michael Vickery's
I'm happy now that you concur this perspective. My point is even that whenever be it a revolutionary flag, be it for interview with Elizabeth Becker, efforts are made to actually make that distinction between, on the one hand, Vietnam, which is the union in a derogatory Vietnam, way because they are the enemy, and those who collaborate with them are KGB or revisionist spies. So let me follow up on this by reading to you an excerpt of a Division 164 cadre. That is, Mr. President, E390/23.3.12. Question and answer.
Mm.
70.
70.
And he says, the question is, you said that there were two kinds of enemies, internal and external. Do you think that the Vietnamese fishermen were regarded as the external enemy and were taken to be killed?
And he says,
I do not think so. The external enemy referred to the Vietnamese soldiers along the border. Regarding the seizures of the Vietnamese boats, to my knowledge, the Vietnamese fishermen were not regarded as the external enemy, but they had violated territorial waters of Democratic Republic of China. So here you might possibly see the result of what was said here in this revolutionary flag, that there is a clear distinction between Vietnamese military, Vietnam, and normal fishermen being not considered enemies. What is your reaction to that?
Thank you. Thank you, Your Honor. Just in terms of that excerpt, I believe you're referring to Mies Hun, that testified.
I cannot say the name, but it is not
that's what I just wanted to clarify.
I hope you still remember the question. Can you give a reaction to this Division 164
guys?
Were you who were external enemies and who weren't?
Thank you, Mr. Co-defense lawyer. Could you clarify what the document is once more? I became confused. I remember your question. I don't remember what exactly the context of this document is.
It is a written record of an interview of a witness. As I mentioned, I cannot tell his name. He was a Division 164 leading cadre. In other words, a Navy person asked questions about Vietnamese fishermen passing the territorial waters. And then he was asked a question as to who are the external enemies, who are they meaning, who are they meaning. This was his reaction.
Thank you, Mr. Co-defense lawyer. It's an interesting passage. So this and the model I set out, again, which begins with upheaval, moves into the process by which difference begins to be manufactured, where the regime in question begins to mark and stigmatize certain sorts of groups, begins to reorganize society so that certain groups are found or put into structures whereby they can be interrogated. As part of this model I put forward, I've also mentioned, it came up in my discussion with the deputy co-prosecutor, talked about the notion of ideological localization and take more broadly as reflective of a situation, and I think also with Judge Laverne, talked about this a bit when he asked about the end of my book, the discussion of the three cadre. But what also happens when have ideological pronouncements, rhetorics that are there, and sometimes if you get diffuse orders that come out on the ground, people can sometimes be confused. And it's something you find in many different cases of violence, where within, I think I referred to it as well, you have these different envelopes, looser or tighter, in terms of the contextual constraints, the structural restraints on the people who are acting. And so you get situations like this where people are not quite sure how to interpret order, so in a way it seems to suggest to me some confusion, seeking clarification. So if we look at comparative studies of genocide, if you look at, for example, the Hutu roadblocks where people, Tutsis would come, or groups of people would come, and they would seek to try and identify the people, and you have this ambiguity that often exists, and people seek clarification. So without further contextual information based on what you've read, it seems to me that this is a situation, an example of someone seeking clarity.
I argue it's the opposite.
He clearly making a distinction between the Vietnamese soldiers on one hand or the Vietnamese army.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Jusqu'à preuve du contraire, l'expert dans cette salle d'audience, c'est Monsieur Hinton, ce n'est pas notre confrère Copé. Donc si notre confrère pouvait arrêter de plaider, ce serait quand même particulièrement intéressant pour nous. Il parle de documents sans les citer. Nous assistons à une discussion, à un échange où notre confrère a tout loisir de plaider depuis maintenant une bonne demi-heure. Donc j'aimerais, Monsieur le Président, que vous rappeliez à notre confrère que son travail dans cette salle d'audience est de poser des questions. Quand il pose des questions à l'expert et qu'il se réfère à des documents, il serait loisible qu'il
May I add something to that? Because I think to a degree, Professor Hinton, you have invited that. You have said, tell me what you think, and then we can have a discourse. This might be how it works in the academic world, but that's not the rules in the court. Actually, counsel should not testify, meaning giving long pleadings on how he thinks evidence should be evaluated. He should provide through questions to you the means for us to evaluate the evidence. So, as I said, to a degree, there might have been a misunderstanding on how the discourse in court actually works out.
I will minimize my argument, but you're right, I was sometimes invited to present it. Let me move on to my next subject, and that is the question of whether there were internal enemies, yes or no. I would like to read now to you an excerpt from a DC Chem statement of someone who actually came to this courtroom and testified later. I believe in your binder you have his in-court testimony. It is, Mr. President, document E3/7516. It is a DC Chem interview of a Division 310 commander. And as you know, Un, whom you referred to quite a bit in your book, was the commander of Division 310. And this Sam Hun, as his name is testifying that Un, the Division 310 commander, had built up forces, hit arms in the former North Zone, part of his forces, DC Chem statement, which was from 2005. Mr. President, just for completeness' sake, I'm referring to 0087-6520 in English, Iran, French 0089-2665, French and Khmer 0002-0598. He's describing events, presumably 76-77. You were saying that Un hit you in Kampuncham. Did you actually transport weapons there? Answer, yes, I did transport weapons to Kampuncham. Question, a war was going to happen, right? What were you then ordered to do with these new weapons? Answer. We were ordered to stand by for further orders. When the time came, we were to transport these weapons on to Kyo's place in Pochentong to attack and seize Pochentong Airport, to attack and seize an artillery and armored vehicle warehouse. Another battalion was ordered to get ready to attack the radio station. However, the plot was revealed and all involved leaders and their associates were arrested. The war could have started any time since 1976. I don't have the time to read to you the evidence that we have now assembled. But there are quite a bit of other Division 310 cadres, Northwest Zone cadres, East Zone cadres, are basically saying that as of 76, possibly 75, an armed rebellion was starting, followed by coup d'etats. Were you aware of this information?
Your Honor, if I can just object. Giving evidence on meeting before the chamber. The council has just given account of some total of evidence he believes is on the case file and what he intends to show. We can't agree with that. It's a conclusion on his part. I think what council should do is stick to the document and the expert can comment on that. That's fine, but he shouldn't give his argument of what he believes is the evidence in this case. As my colleague has just said, he's pleading, he's not actually asking questions.
I'm not pleading, Mr. President. I'm giving a very tiny bit of context. I need to explain Mr. Hinton who Sam Hoon was, that there were other people in Division 310 like Sam Hoon who said the same thing, that there are quite a number of cadres in the Northwest Zone. So I need to give context.
Your Honor, if I can just add, but it's got to be accurate. That's the problem. This is 75, 76, lots of other people in different places. Your Honours have read the document. Each document says something quite different. There's not a uniformity of evidence on this type of issue. So that's the problem. It's not giving context. It's actually giving evidence as to what the sum total of the evidence is. And we disagree with that.
Mr. President, I have about 20 to 25 statements, WRIs. I'm happy to read them all, but I only have limited time. I chose the one who I thought the expert could relate to most because he talks about Un, he talks about Khmer quite a bit in his book. So rather than confronting him with all the Northwest Zone cadres who openly speak about rebellion or East Zone people, I concentrated on one in particular, Sam Hoon. And I wanted to know if he knew about this and whether he was able to give a reaction. That's all what I'm doing.
I don't think there's a problem with the question. There was a problem with the characterization of the other evidence. We have heard that the prosecutor doesn't agree with it. So the suggestion to the expertise, answer the question on the basis of the document you are getting, if you can, and discard what you heard as to what counsel thinks the other evidence might amount to, because there's obviously no agreement among the parties.
Thank you, Your Honor. Could you just, again, reread that, though, because I've just forgotten exactly. I want to be specific.
No problem. In order to be a bit quicker, summarize Semhun's testimony, also the testimony that he gave in court. He has given evidence which seems to suggest, I'll be very neutral, Mr. Prosecutor, seems to suggest that he was involved in the preparation of an armed rebellion. He was involved in a coup d'etat against the party center, and that parts of this rebellion, certain acts were the attack of Division 310 soldiers on Pochitong Airport, the attack on Radio Phnom Penh, the moving about of weapons. Everything that you need in order to overthrow the UK government, presumably have either Khartoum or others at its head.
Thank you, Mr. Co-defense lawyer. I think the other important detail is exactly what year is he, what month and year is he speaking about?
76, 75, 76, 70, early 70.
Thank you, Mr. Co-defense lawyer. I guess, so if we go back to my book, as well, and we talk about Riep, it seems clear that Riep rebelled. His patronage networks have been cut out. So there's an example of a padre seeking somehow to try and rebel against Pak. So I assume that this is something that occurred at times. Information, I'm sure this trial chamber will investigate and come to a determination about the extent to which there were such actual rebellions that took place. But I want to go back again to the point I made before, invoking the work of Michael Vickery, who you mentioned about not having a standardized view, but one that looks at temporal variation as well as spatial variation. And to say the document comes from 1975, 1976, maybe 1977, removes this document from a temporal flow. It seems to me that this would have been much more likely in early 1977, maybe late 1976, if it were in fact the case. I think it would be doubtful in 1975, but it's something that certainly worth considering. But again, in doing it, I think it's very important to be specific about the moment, what's going on in terms of the politics of Democratic Kampuchea. Because like I say, 1977, Riep tried to stage a rebellion, apparently. So that did take place. But he does not appear to have been someone who wanted to stage a rebellion, from what we can tell, in mid-1976, for example. So I think, again, and I know you invoke the work of Michael Vickery, this historical temporal flow is important to look at the variation.
Just to be clear, I'm not invoking Vickery at all when it comes to the existence of a rebellion. Ben Keenan spoke to GSM and Heng Samrin, document E3/1158, in which ERN0065-1889, in which Heng Samrin, the leader of the PRK government, the one referred to by the King Father as Vietnam's puppet, said 1976-77, we had a struggle, but a secret one. Can you give a reaction to that particular answer?
I'm going to talk to you about the question. I'm going to talk to you.
Your Honor, I think that's quite difficult. It's one line out of this statement. And if defense counsel is referring to armed resistance in the sort of mid-1978, I think he should get straight to the point. But picking one line out and putting it to this witness completely out of context, without, I'm not sure whether he's got a document before him to look at, seems like a very arbitrary exercise. He wants to put, was there any resistance in mid-1978 in the East Zone, he should just put it. But this sort of line-by-line amorphous discussion about what does he mean, it's very much out of context. And I think it's very difficult for this expert to have anything meaningful to say.
If I do it in general terms, it's not good. If I actually use a document, it isn't any good.
I believe
that's what Heng Samrin said. He defected to Vietnam in
78.
It is my proposition the rebellion or the secret struggle
I've got no objection to the question, but the premise that somehow or another the statement that Heng Samrin gave imports that there was some sort of rebellion happening in 75 or 76, 77. I'll just read further down the lines, just so that your honors can see it's out of context. Says, but at that time it was tight, cramped. There was no opportunity to rise up and struggle. Even Ta Pim had to struggle. He used to say, we'll have further bloodshed, but there was no opportunity. And then he goes on about opportunity coming later in 1978. So it's just not a good characterization of his evidence.
Let me bring you right up to 78 then, and let's cross the bridge, that would be very helpful. Hinton, have you heard of a plenum meeting of Central Committee of the Vietnamese Workers' Party in February 1978, in which start of an internal rebellion led by Sopin, if that wouldn't work, then invade Cambodia, which it subsequently did. Have you ever heard of a fourth plenum of the Vietnamese Workers' Party, February 78?
I believe maybe looking at court documents, I've come across that. In general, I should say that reviewing confessions, again, of which we can't look at the content, this sort of discourse comes up. Looking at documents like the last plan, these sorts of things come back. If you look at Padre notebooks, these sorts of thoughts come up. So specifically, do I remember an informant telling me about this? I don't, but certainly in documentation, things of this sort have been brought up. I should mention more broadly that, I think that it's great if we can clarify historical understanding about the dynamics and process that took place. There were potential rebellions that, as we move through time, took place. It's a great benefit to learn about that. But I think, nevertheless, the issue at hand in terms of genocide is an issue of people being killed, you know, if we go down back to Region 41, Kampong Siam District, the Jams being rounded up and taken and killed, you know, if we talk about these macro-level dynamics, the issue at hand in terms of the genocide committed against ethnic Jam and ethnic Vietnamese, that reality is still ongoing. So we're talking about macro-level events that relate to micro-level events, but I think it's important not to create a historical narrative that glosses over the death of many people and the suffering of many people on the local level. But having said that, it's important to also clarify the historical record and certainly the defense position, prosecution, the civil parties, you know, our understanding of this time in history will increase greatly, and I look forward to the judgment.
Let me clarify to you that when I was speaking about the fourth plenum of the Vietnamese Workers' Party in February 1978, I wasn't referring to any confession or S21 documents. Obviously, we are forbidden to do so. I was referring to a book by someone you mentioned earlier today, Nayang Chanda, E3/2376, I was also referring to a book of another scholar, American scholar, also one of the experts on Vietnamese policy. It's a man related to the University of California at Berkeley, William Duyker. His book is called China and Vietnam, The Roots of Conflict. That fourth plenum. Let me combine two Chanda says the Vietnamese Politburo met again in mid-February in the outskirts of Ho Chi Minh City, a secluded compound for what used to be the police training school of the former Che regime. The meeting studied the nuts and bolts of the plan for setting up a Cambodian Communist Party and a resistance organization. Let me now move to William Duyker. He says, at the February plenum, the Vietnamese Party leadership had approved a proposal to remove the Pol Pot regime by an internal uprising. The key to the success of the strategy lay in the emergence of the resistance movement strong enough to challenge the Pol Pot regime's power. But in May, Pol Pot's forces attacked rebel headquarters and Sopim was captured and executed. It goes on a bit, but in the interest of time, I will cut it short here. This evidence from these two scholars seems to suggest that, although we believe it was much earlier, but that at least in February 78, Vietnam actively decided to support an internal uprising. And then if that wouldn't work, that is maybe our conclusion, would invade and take over.
What is your reaction to that?
Thank you, Mr. Co-defense lawyer. Again, it would be valuable to have these documents sort of marked so I can review them ahead of time. Having said that, certainly, at first, for some reason, I thought you were in 1975. I was mistaken when you spoke before and misheard. But certainly by February 1978, that certainly could have been a possibility. Not surprising me at all. That there was some sort of discussion of trying to topple the
regime. So you're not disputing that decision
I think counsel's gone as far as he can go with that. He said it could have been a possibility that that document existed. There's not much more he can say.
I think Mr. Hinton is perfectly capable of saying this is all I can say. And if he has additional information, I'm sure he can provide
it.
Thank you, Mr. Co-defense lawyer. Again, I believe what I said, now I can't remember exactly what I said, but is that the possibility that Vietnam was beginning to try and foment some type of struggle against the DK regime at this period of time is certainly possible, having, again, not having reviewed the documents, not having read the long passages from which these excerpts come from, I'm basing my response on a very thin amount of material. So again, I wouldn't want to be definitively on the record one way or the other, but the possibility is certainly there. And I think more broadly, you know, the point that at different moments in time, there were factions that may have decided to try and rebel, contacted Vietnam. But looking at the historical and temporal variation in that, is critical as opposed to saying there was a singular unidimensional plot all along leading from 1975 to 1979. That seems to me a nuanced and a sort of standardized view. So, again, historical and temporal variation, looking at the context, something like that is a possibility. And again, I think that I look forward to the deepening of our understanding of this period of time by all the evidence introduced in this court.
The reason I'm asking these questions is because I mentioned that earlier. In total, 25 times, you used the word paranoia when it came to the parties and dealing with internal enemies, people who they believed were betraying DK by working together with Vietnam 15 times. Can you first of all explain what you base yourself when you say that 25 times when it comes to arrests, etc. The Party Center was handled by paranoia.
Thank you, Mr. Co-defense lawyer. Thank you for counting the number of times. I have no idea. I've never counted. Just to be clear, I don't think I ever said they were only driven by paranoia. I don't think I ever said only driven by paranoia, which I wouldn't say. But certainly, if you go to the S-21 confessions, if you go to the last point, there's copious evidence that the regime over time increasingly is developed to drill or perceived plots and coups emerged, became increasingly paranoid, and in response to that initiated a series of purges in which large numbers of people were killed that had ramifications that went all the way down into the local level, where entire strings of people were taken away, and ultimately the attempt to purify the country in general of suspect elements. You began over the course of time the idea that there was an element of paranoia driving the DK regime and the CPK is fairly uncontested, non-controversial within the study of this period. To say it's the only thing that drove them would be absolutely incorrect. And again, I said real or perceived plots and coups, but as an element that helped fuel this process, it was an element. And go back, for example, to David Chandler's account of S-21. He's a person who consists in his discussions, to mention someone you've heard from sometimes.
I will get back to that paranoia.
Nhóm nâng này dây mọi dây ông pi chụp ngư thật đẹp vậy nên làm quỳnh.
Have you, do you know what happened in 1968?
Lúc đăng tế miền bắc cát lang nông chín năm một bốn rồi chặt sập làm bay chụp môi nâng xã hiệp xu viết có đôi chơi chụp môi nâng chek bte chek Kosovoaki.
Thank you, Mr. Co-Defense Lawyer. I do. I think what would be, if I can make a request, again, going back to what I said earlier, that as opposed to beginning with a very sort of singular question, if you could explain the question that you're going to ask, then I could...
I'm going to go straight to the point. Beforehand. Chanda describes
on the
same page that I just
mentioned, a visit in January 1978 of a Soviet
general, Grigorievich Pavlovsky,
Grigorievich Pavlovsky,
he's arriving in Laos and
got man model Vietnam
special Aeroflot jetliner for a friendly visit.
Đội chỉ dân họ mò tìm nút trong tổng đọc rộng rộng bằng trầy cả phía chết rộng bỏ Việt Nam Ngô Vinh Diệp miền ca chụp bật chung mua chung mua ở Đông Sơn này xù viết đồng bây bình đất mơ sát thang lập hiếp nước Campuchia
Pavlovsky's advice
ở Đông Sơn này Pavlovsky bàn đo dục bòl xâm đọc rộng từ trấu tế vì phía xa chỉ mỗi nâng kháng chế cố sở lạc kỳ phòng đài bằng chọn phát đạo sông. Ta trăm trâu đài tế. Thà Việt Nam nế bàn xã ca kênh chỉ mỗi nâng kháng chế cố sở lạc kỳ nơi chân nằm bằng bằng bồn rồi chất sập rộng bay.
Perhaps you could elaborate on what you mean exactly by did a Czechoslovakia. Talking about troops coming in, Russian troops coming in, toppling regime, so on and so forth. But to say they did a Czechoslovakia explicitly, it seems like an overreach. But certainly, having that metaphor, the idea of toppling a government, certainly could have been mentioned. I wouldn't be surprised if it was mentioned in your reading Nayan Chanda, so it seems like a good source.
As a matter of fact, I'm not sure if we sent that to you beforehand, but
I believe
it's by heart,
it's 3/13,
is talking to all generals of his divisions, including Un,
and after the arrest, Chuk, Yas,
he is saying exactly that is what DK is saying.
I don't think that was the actual threat to its sovereignty, its national security.
Are you in position to answer my question?
Maybe you could just repeat the question again.
It's about the fact that Vietnam was a real enemy. Let me go to your book. And let me give you a few examples of your use of the word paranoia 25 times. In English, ERN 0043153, you say the following, it's your book. While the Khmer Rouge had periodically purged its ranks in the past, Pol Pot's obsession with finding the sickness that was rotting society after rapid escalation of the party's center, paranoia, quickly reached places like region 41 in the central zone. The suspect English ERN 0043-1-6-0-7-0-7-4-5-3. Nevertheless, tool slang continued to uncover plots newer than imagined, thus fueling the party center's paranoia.
And I think if you another reason for the paranoia, and my question is, how does
that word that you use, paranoia, relate to the documents that I've confronted you with?
Thank you, Mr. Co-defense lawyer. So again, I would return to something I said before. Goes back to something you said originally, that I think it's a standardized, reductive manner of speaking to simply say Vietnam was a real enemy, as if that existed from 1975 until 1979, everywhere, with all people, all members of the CPK, with no nuance, no change. If you look at Nguyen Chan's book, his argument, it's precisely the opposite. He argues that actually Vietnam, it was a process, a dialogic process, a back and forth, and that Vietnam did not have a singular plot from the beginning. They had different discussions that transpired over time, and their position was fluid and changing. So I think that source is not well put for this case. I certainly would stand by the notion of paranoia. I believe that you can have fears that have some basis in reality, but also become spun into fantasy quite readily and become paranoia. And I think especially after early 1976, as illustrated by the establishment of S-41, by illustrated by the spirals and spirals of confessions that were produced, as people were brought in from all over the country by the confessions that were manufactured there. I think there's abundant evidence that this regime had a paranoid element to it, but having said that, it was not solely paranoid to know everything. It was an aspect of a large process. The impression to come across that I say the reason that the violence in DK occurred was solely because of paranoia, that would be a reduction of my argument, which is much more nuanced in the book. And I would again reiterate the point, and I'm sorry to repeat it over and over again, but it's one that you initially invoked by talking about Michael Vickery. It's important to look at temporal flow and spatial flow over time, and not to draw standardized uniform conclusions about a situation that was more fluid, dialogic, dynamic, and varied from place to place from time to time.
But aren't you doing the exact same thing, calling everything or most of it paranoia is also a very reductionist view of events? Simplistic in my belief, but isn't it also a very reductionist version or vision of historical events?
Thank you, Mr. Co-defense lawyer. I believe I basically just said exactly the same thing. It's something I stressed before in relationship to the book I wrote, Manor Monster, and the different ways we can have reductive explanations like introduced qualities like savagery, barbarism, sadism, so on and so forth in a singular manner to other human beings and groups. What I said, what's apparent from a close reading of my book, is that this was one amongst a number of factors. It was a factor that emerged over time as the purges began to escalate, as confessions came in from S-21. And as you know from reading the different chapters of my book, I argue that actually there are a number of factors that are involved, not just one. So I think it's very, again, I want to emphasize that it's a multifactorial process. This is one factor. I link it in two notions of patronage, understandings of power, notions of instability and patronage relationships. I do this at length in my book. And so it's also a mischaracterization of my book. It's a reduction of my book. It's a reduction of my argument. And I think it's, to say that I'm arguing that paranoia drove the process when I'm arguing precisely the opposite. And I'm careful to qualify that. I noted in the argument. And again, you need to talk about, you know, if you raise this, the larger argument when I talk about suspicion, patronage, and so forth, as well as other chapters of the book. So I think, you know, having said that, we're agreed it's important to avoid reductionist explanations, including a reductionist explanation that seeks to argue that there was a singular plot that existed on behalf of the Vietnamese government that was the same everywhere in all times. I think that's a reductionist argument as well. So we're agreed that we need to pay attention to nuance.
Let me turn to my very last subject, which I believe also a very reductionist view. English ERN 0085 4 3 2 0 Khmer 0006 4 5 4 6, no French. And the other document that we'll read it together is the document Pol Pot Plans the Future.
It's
206, it's 001-004-00. Let me start reading the excerpt in relation to new people and old.
Sure, no problem, Mr. President. First document is a revolutionary flag, December 77, January 78. It's E3/725, no French ERN, English 0085-4320, Khmer 0006 4 5 4 5 and 6 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 4 5 Talking about new and old people. Can you give me your reaction to these two excerpts, which I believe is quite more nuanced in relation to the treatment of new and old people than shown in the documents that were read to you before?
Uh,
Thank you, Mr. Co-Defense Lawyer. Could you please, again, you may have said it, but I lost the thread. What are the dates of the documents?
One is 1976.
And the other is Revolutionary Flag of 77, December and January
78.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Co-Defense Lawyer. Again, these are two documents that emerged, and I think, as I said before, they go back to Region 41 of the Central Zone, the Northern Zone, eventually becoming the Central Zone. You had temporal variation where first conditions were good. I believe that immediately after the beginning of the DK period, there was an attempt to sharpen the consciousness, to re-educate many people. So there was an attempt to do that. And I think as the purges began and began this element of paranoia that you don't like, but again, the fear that there was internal subversion from within, fear that people were betraying the revolution, as the cycle began to emerge, the existing differentiations on the ground that existed at that point in particular. And again, there's temporal and spatial variation, as Michael Vickery pointed out, as noted, commune have some differences. But again, during that phase, especially after mid-1976, for this document, you said 1976, but you didn't specify the month, I believe.
ឆ្នាំ 76 លោក មក ប្រាប់ ខែ របស់ ខ្ញុំ ទេ ឯក សារ ទី 1
December 76
ខែ ធ្នូ ចុះ ខែ ធ្នូ ឆ្នាំ 76
Yeah. So you may have this current, but it's also the same time, for example, you have the microbes speech being given, that there are internal microbes that need to be rooted out. So there's a great deal of other incitement literature that exists at this point in time. But I do believe, especially once the CPK regime became aware of the number of deaths, saw that their battle with Vietnam was going badly, that later on in 1978, you began to get more discourse that it's necessary to not be as harsh on the populace, and I believe closer even before the time period you just mentioned, but initially there was the idea that people could potentially be re-educated or reform many of the people. And so if you look at the rhetoric that exists, even as the Khmer Republic officials were being purged often, people went out from the cities in many different locations in Cambodia, they're not all. People said that at first, you know, they were there, and then over time things got more and more difficult, especially as you moved into the 1977, and many different places conditions deteriorated and became worse. So again, I think sort of the spatial and temporal variation point.
Let me interrupt you because I only have a few more minutes. I read out contemporaneous DK documents talking about new people, an overwhelming majority being good, being patriotic. Read out documents in which there's a clear distinction between Vietnamese people on one hand and Vietnam on the other hand. You said you are an expert in quote-unquote, genocidal propaganda. Can you just compare the things that I've read to you? For instance, the vitriolic, anti-Semitic propaganda in the
Nazi
propaganda newspaper, or for that matter, the radio and TV stations in Rwanda calling for the extermination of the Inyenzi, the cockroaches. How did these two things relate to each other?
Thank you, Mr. Co-Defense Lawyer.
Again,
there are several responses to issues you've raised. First of all, I should note that you're shifting into what I referred before as the problem of immediately falling into a Holocaust prototype to say that something has to be a Holocaust in order to be a genocide. That seems to be the implicit suggestion. The dynamics of the Holocaust, genocide in general, are much more complex complicated. I've laid out a framework for understanding this.
That's why I use
Rwanda
as example as well.
Yeah.
So, as I was saying, again, to talk about the direct Holocaust analogy you invoke, having said that, if you go get the book, I think, Henri Locard's book on the sayings of the Khmer Rouge, if you look through there, you do have like the micro speech that's very well known, that was December 1976, the same time as the passage you read. You have all sorts of metaphors that often are more adapted to an agrarian environment where people are farming. So you get the reference to, for example, plant parasites as opposed to biological parasites. So it's a very different frame of understanding. Having Schaeff from
obviously not about the new people. People who commit treason by working together with the Vietnamese. That's a different
totally
different
I
think the expert should be able to finish his answer. To respond to a significant sort of conclusionary type question, I think.
Isn't there, and that's my last question, isn't there a very big difference between those contemporaneous DK documents and Nazi propaganda versus Jews or Polish people or Inuits or Rwandan Hutu propaganda
Thank you, Mr. Co-defense lawyer. Again, I appreciate not being interrupted. If I could just finish because it breaks my train of thought. As I was saying before, there are a different set of metaphors that are operative on the local level. If you also want to begin to look at the targeting of new people, people who are regarded as having reactionary, subversive, counter-revolutionary tendencies, those who are unable to sharpen their consciousness and purify themselves on the local level, when orders come down to purify the ranks, and those orders come from a wide variety of incitement, discourse, propaganda, sometimes explicit orders, sometimes through broadcasts, which to answer the second part of your question, to me is directly parallel to those sorts of rhetorics that they directly parallel, so I think you're wrong about that. When those orders come down, you have those existing structural divisions on the ground where groups have been marked, identified as other, they've been dehumanized. As we go down to the ledger books that were kept, the names of the people, former occupations are there, orders come down to purify the ranks, to see gaps of verses, look in the ledger books, they have the names, they have it at the sub-district level and at the village level, and they take people away and they kill them. It's something that's well chronicled. It fits the lived experience of the people that I interview. Again, I think there's a huge amount of information that exists, ranging from scholarly accounts to memoirs that support this as having taken place. And again, I refer you to the book, Pol Pot's Proverbs, different metaphors of the Khmer Rouge, and there are all sorts of dehumanizing metaphors that are in that book. You can refer to numerous DK radio broadcasts, the same thing exists there. So yes, I think that you can draw a direct parallel. And again, this process of manufacturing difference that I referred to, the parallels in that regard between the Holocaust and the Cambodian genocide are very clear and very direct, as they are with other ideological genocides.
My very last question,
give me one example of it. CPK document or DK document, which it actually literally says new people should be prosecuted or exterminated, Vietnamese citizens should be
deported. Where is the document that actually
explicitly says that?
តើមានភស្តុតាងឬគឺចំណុចណាមួយនៅក្នុងឯកសារសម័យកាលកម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យនិយាយចំណុចនឹងថាអញ្ចឹងទេ
Thank you, Mr. Co-Defense Lawyer. I didn't realize that I was supposed to come prepared with a set of documentation to introduce into the court on my own. But having said that, no, that's not true. As I've talked about in my book, I discussed, for example, the lived experience of people on the ground and the categories that were invoked. I talked before about TIP, the orders that were received. Other sub-district heads talked about receiving orders to root out new people, former Khmer Rouge officials, students, professionals, suspected subversive elements, to go back and now go back to the revolutionary flag sitting on the stand without the documentation. Anyways, again,
this is my final question and remark. Just name me one contemporary document in which it actually says new people should be persecuted or Vietnamese
be prosecuted. ថាត្រូវតែបោះសម្អាតកំទេចប្រជាជនថ្មី
ត្រូវតែបោះសម្អាតកំទេច
ជនជាតិវៀតណាម
The expert, Your Honor, was answering the question.
He
interrupted him to answer exactly the same question. So I don't know what was meant to be achieved by that.
But he wanted to continue with his answer before he interrupted, Your Honor.
មានអ្វីបំពេញបន្ថែមនៅសំណួរចុងក្រោយដែរទេលោកអ្នកជំនាញសំណួរចុងក្រោយបង្អស់របស់មេធាវីការពារក្តីលោកវីទ័រកូពេអមៃមិញនេះ
អមៃឌូ Thank you Your Honor thank you Mr. Co-Defense Lawyer starting with ethnic Vietnamese I think we talked at length in many instances of incitement literatureRhetorics of hate against UNs, which I say can be referred both to people from Vietnam and to ethnic Vietnamese. So that's already been introduced and discussed. You've shifted over to new people. I would argue that the different rhetorics to root out internal subversives, the way the orders were interpreted on the ground, again, I would like to go back and review the literature. I know you're asking that question, but the way those orders go out and interpreted are such that the people with those regressive tendencies,The way it's interpreted, the people are taken away, are new people who have qualities of belonging to the classes that are being targeted by the CPK, former people associated with capitalism. So again, if you want to look at, instead of perhaps framing your question in terms of the new people to think of class categories, the notion of subversives, counter-revolutionaries, that's abundant and clear as well.
A lot of words, Mr. President, but no answer. Thank you.
Got to lie very ngay, ko pon da men piak na muoy chlai top tu nu samnuol sam te som akun.
Mr. President, if I can just say something here, I think this type of criticism of the expert, I think we've had enough of it. There was an answer, and we talk about reductionism, trying to reduce something to a document. The expert was giving a full explanation, and I think it's not appropriate that the expert is on the tail end of these critical remarks.
យ៉ាងពេញចំហឹងក្នុងការឆ្លើយតបទៅនឹងសំណួរជាច្រើនដ៏លំបាកចំពោះមុខនៅពេលនេះហើយឥឡូវនេះក៏ដល់ពេលសម្រាប់ហើយអមប្រកាសសម្រាប់ចាប់ពីពេលនេះតទៅរហូតដល់ម៉ោង 3:10 សូមអញ្ជើញចូលវិញដើម្បីបន្តកិច្ចដំណើរការសមាការមន្ត្រីរដ្ឋបាលសាលាការរួមរួមផ្ដល់កន្លែងសម្រាប់នៅបន្ទប់រងចាំសម្រាប់សាក់សីដល់សាក់សីជំនាញរូបនេះនៅក្នុងឡុងពេលជុំសម្រាប់និងឲ្យជួយគាត់មកកាន់កន្លែងដល់សក្កិកម្មក្នុងបន្ទប់សម្រាប់ការនេះវិញនៅវេលាម៉ោង 3:10 សម្រាប់ចុះ
សូមអញ្ជើញក្រោកឈរ